Good evening.
I'd like to extend a warm welcome to my teacher, Sergei Babayan, and to my advisor, Susan McClary. To my friends in the audience, thank you for coming, and to those who are watching online on livestream.com, thank you for tuning in. I'm excited to present my final project towards earning the Doctor of Musical Arts degree at CIM. It's been a long and difficult journey, but luckily I found great support in my teachers, friends, family, and in the music. We are about to deal tonight with Ravel's La Valse, an iconic 20th century piece, in my opinion, the same level of Stravinsky's Rite of Spring. It is one of Ravel's most known and successful works, but also one that took him a very long time to bring from conception to completion. La Valse exists in versions for piano and two pianos, as well as for the orchestra. But unlike other cross-genre works by Ravel, it is not regarded as an original piano work, but as a transcription. In my lecture, I will first give some historical background about the circumstances of composition and trying to get down to the meaning of the music and the role of the piano in all of it. Then I will suggest a few solutions on how to tackle La Valse in terms of performance on the piano, finishing with my performance. So, let's start. La Valse was first conceived in 1906 as homage to Johann Strauss's waltzes, then titled Wien. Wien was dedicated to Monsieur Sert, who was a pianist, socialite, and friend to Ravel. Monsieur Sert was also the dedicatee of Stravinsky's Rite of Spring. The next reference we have of Wien is in Ravel's letters of 1914, regarded as a symphonic poem. We have no surviving evidence of the composition process, but an interruption to his work on Wien is mentioned in his letters. It is possible that he sketched ideas only to destroy them later, as was the case with most of his sketches. This was a troubling time for Ravel, as World War I broke out July 1914. His brother served in the army. Ravel himself attempted to enlist several times and was rejected due to his small physique. So he volunteered to treat wounded soldiers, until in March 1915, he was finally accepted for the military service and joined the 13th Artillery Regiment as a truck or ambulance driver and mechanic. He then puts aside Wien once more for the next few years, but letters from that time shows that Wien still preoccupies his mind. In his recollection of the war, Ravel shows patriotic character, but also portrays the life-threatening situations he was in. Following the hardship he suffered in the war, there is a drastic decline in composition. The only new pieces were Le Tombeau de Couperin from 1917 and Frontispiece from 1918, both pieces related in their shared theme of war. The death of his mother in January 1917 contributed immensely to the turmoil he felt those days. Following the war, we see a total stylistic change in his music. He started to use expanded harmonic language, more dissonances, while also destabilizing conventional tonal frames and evocating old forms, neoclassical and neo-baroque, while also borrowing elements from other aesthetics, mainly from jazz. The year 1919 brings us back to Wien. Sergei Diaghilev, the famous impresario and owner of the Ballet Russe company, commissions Ravel to write a ballet. Diaghilev's relationship with Ravel in the past was not amicable in their collaboration on Daphnis and Chloe, but Ravel seized the opportunity to resume work on Wien. He then retitled it La Valse, a choreographic poem. With almost revitalized energy, it was composed quickly between December 1919 and April 1920. The following May, it was played to Diaghilev at Monsieur Sert's apartment. Important attendees to this historical event, other than Diaghilev and Sert, were Stravinsky, Massin, who was the intended choreographer, Marcel Mayer, who played the piece with Ravel, and Poulenc, who wrote the following fascinating account of the event. Ravel arrived very simply with his music under his arm, and Diaghilev said to him in that nasal voice of his, "Well now, my dear Ravel, how lucky we are to be hearing La Valse." And Ravel played La Valse with Marcel Mayer, not very well maybe, but anyway, it was Ravel's La Valse. Now at the time I knew Diaghilev very well, and I saw the false teeth begin to move, then the monocle. I saw he was embarrassed, I saw he didn't like it, and was going to say, "No." When Ravel had got to the end, Diaghilev said something which I think is very true. He said, "Ravel, it is a masterpiece, but it's not a ballet. It's the portrait of a ballet. It's the painting of a ballet." And I think that's the reason why no one has ever choreographed La Valse successfully. But the extraordinary thing was, Stravinsky said not a word. Diaghilev's refusal not only damaged his relationship with Ravel even further, but also transformed La Valse from the intended medium of the ballet to become a successful concert piece for the orchestra. It was premiered as such in December 12, 1920 in Paris. Ballet production of La Valse during his lifetime did not gain popularity. First mounted by the Royal Flemish Opera Ballet in Antwerp in 1926, and later received its main production in Paris by the ballet Ida Rubinstein in 1929. It was choreographed by Bronislava Nijinska, and set and costumes were designed by Alexandre Benoit. The Rubinstein production was criticized as incompatible with the music, and even after receiving some success in a revised production in 1931, reviewers felt the dance had very little to Ravel's imaginative score. This must be what Poulenc meant in his recollection. In addition to being rather short for a ballet, La Valse had no clear plot line. Ravel wrote his argument for the ballet, which was published with the music score, and reads as follows. "Through breaks in the swirling clouds, waltzing couples may be glimpsed. Little by little they disperse, an immense hall filled with a whirling crowd can be made out, letter A. The stage is illuminated gradually, the light of the chandeliers peaks at the fortissimo, letter B. An imperial court about 1855. While it is a cinematic description, it applies only to the beginning of La Valse, as the letterhead suggests, and does not explain the enigma of the piece's meaning. Many commentators, even in Ravel's lifetime, tried to interpret the piece in extra-musical perspectives, but Ravel was quick in contradicting them, stressing the dominant musical process in the piece, which is supported only by the dance. He said in an interview, "It doesn't have anything to do with the present situation in Vienna, and it also doesn't have any symbolic meaning in that regard. In the course of La Valse, I did not envision a dance of death or a struggle between life and death. I changed the original title Vienne to La Valse, which is more in keeping with the aesthetic nature of the composition. It is a dancing, whirling, almost hallucinatory ecstasy, an increasingly passionate and exhausting whirlwind of dancers who are overcome and exhilarated by nothing but the waltz." It seems as if Ravel deliberately shrouded his work in mystery. Perhaps like Stravinsky, who experienced failure at the hands of Diaghilev, Ravel sought the endurance of his music by detaching it from its original context. Of the many associations attributed to La Valse, the most common are socio-political content and influence from literary models. David Epstein interprets La Valse as a metaphor for the European culture, represented by the rich Viennese style, a culture that deteriorated with World War I. He finds the qualities of despair, destruction, and inevitability in the score in the form of the foreboding opening and the cataclysmic ending. More important, according to Epstein, not only are these ideas present in the piece, but they should be emphasized by the performer. Other readings of La Valse deal with its romantic quality, namely the theme of death. In his dictated autobiography, Ravel called the piece, and I quote, a sort of apotheosis of the Viennese waltz, mingled with, in my mind, the impression of a fantastic, fatal whirling, end quote. Two ballet productions from the 1950s exploited these ideas. First was Leonid Massin, who linked it with Mikhail Lermontov's play Masquerade, bringing to La Valse a story of high culture, jealousy, revenge, and murder. Is it possible that as the intended choreographer for the piece before it was rejected by Diaghilev, Massin discussed these ideas with Ravel? Or maybe it was Ravel who led Massin in this direction? Later, Georges Balanchine associated his production of La Valse with Edgar Allan Poe's The Mask of the Red Death. Ravel was a known admirer of Poe's, referring to him in interviews as his teacher, and confessing how he was influenced by his principles of poetry. Balanchine's ballet presents a vague plot, but there are strong connections to Poe's short story, mostly in the themes of darkness, masks, and the grotesque. As in The Mask of the Red Death, the topic of death is personified as a character. Death lures the female lead to a dance, which eventually ends in her death. In a dramatic ending, she's hoisted up to the air on her back with arms spread to the side, a sort of reference to the death by dance sequence in the Rite of Spring sacrificial dance. I would like to now show you a video from the New York Ballet's production of Balanchine's La Valse.
I'm Sarah Mearns, and I'm dancing the ballerina role in George Balanchine's La Valse. This is a very eerie and gothic, mysterious ballet. You always know that something bad is gonna happen. We are at this party and we're dancing, and then all of a sudden everybody falls to the floor and everything around me stops. I feel this presence behind me, but I don't know what it is. And he makes me dance, and he makes me just do whatever he wants me to do, and I have no control over it. I feel like when I get out there on stage, I don't control anything that I'm doing, even though we've rehearsed it. I really just fling myself all over the place and let him dictate everything that happens. I fling myself so much that I put my neck out every single time. The next morning, I always cannot move. This next section is really stressful because you're really good at dancing on stage, but when you have to dress yourself or do anything else, you get really nervous. I actually made them put a magnet on the necklace because it used to be a hook and eye, and I could never get it closed. He shows me a mirror, but I don't want to look in it, and it's scary, but then he entices me, and then all of a sudden I do want to look at myself. It's like he's fooling me into becoming this dark creature of his. And then when you put the gloves on, you have to twist this metal ring that's at the end of the glove so the glove can stay up on your arm. And if you don't, the glove will fall down and you don't have that much time to do it. And then you'll see here, we're supposed to close the dress. But I was unable to close it in the right amount of time, and I was so flustered, and I was just like, whatever, I'm just gonna keep going. And the dress just stayed open. You just have to focus on what you have to do next and not let the audience know that that was not supposed to happen. It's live theater, so anything can happen, and it's never gonna be perfect, but I have to stay in character. When I was first cast in this ballet, I was over the moon excited because I knew that I could just completely get wrapped up in this dramatic role. I feel it's kind of perfect for me. The costumes, the music, the dancing, the acting, it's kind of everything wrapped up in one.
They don't show it in the video, but this is an image of the ending of Balanchine's La Valse, referencing the Rite of Spring. Should we accept Ravel's dismissal of this kind of themes in La Valse? Did he compose it as a piece of absolute music without any outer influence? This is hard to believe. After experiencing the horrors of war and the loss of his mother, Ravel was consumed by the death. His morbid state of mind at the time of composing La Valse is revealed in his letter of December 1919, expressing the feelings over the death of his mother. I had forgotten that Christmas Eve had passed. My New Year's Eve will be grim. I'm thinking of those in former years, in the charming apartment on Avenue Carnot, where I was so happy. I'm thinking that it will soon be 3 years since she had departed, and my despair increases daily. I'm thinking about it even more since I have resumed work, that I no longer have this dear silent presence enveloping me with her infinite tenderness, which was, I see it now more than ever, my only reason for living. These days, La Valse is considered as an astounding concert piece, yet it originated at the piano. Two versions predate the orchestral score, piano solo and two pianos. Assigning these versions to the title Transcription is thus misleading. Why, unlike other of his works that exist in multiple versions for piano or orchestra, was La Valse excluded from belonging to his piano music category? Many artists who recorded his complete works for piano did not include La Valse in the mix, surely not because they doubt its value as a composition, but rather due to its problematic status. One possible explanation could be found in the composition chronology compared to other orchestrated works. Take, for example, his famous Pavan that took over 10 years to orchestrate, or Alborada del Grazioso from Miroirs that was first composed in 1904-1905 and orchestrated 13 years later. In La Valse, Ravel began work almost simultaneously on all versions, finishing the piano versions in February 1920 and the orchestration later in April. The earlier pieces had time to mature in their identity as definitive piano works, and La Valse did not. Perhaps those who disregard La Valse as a piano piece link it with Daphne St. Chloe's piano reduction. This comparison suggests that the piano versions of La Valse were made for functional reasons, domestic use, or rehearsal. It doesn't explain why two separate versions were needed for that. Additionally, the piano score for Daphnis is really a vocal score, containing the parts sung by the choir and complete with descriptions of the ballet scenario throughout. That isn't the case in La Valse. Furthermore, the writing in Daphnis is extremely difficult and awkward, like in this example from the famous Le Verre du Jour scene, extending the line to four staves. Compared to Daphnis, the piano solo version of La Valse adapts more easily for performance, and the two piano version isn't problematic at all in its pianistic approach. So why did Ravel need two so-called rehearsal versions? I believe that these are not intended for rehearsal, but rather exist as experimental versions in the grueling process to perfect his orchestration. He starts small first with a piano solo version, includes instrumental cues and orchestral references in osseous staves, then expand tremendously for the two pianos with more elaborate texture and harmony, richer sonorities and polyphony. The manuscript for the piano solo version that you see on the screen, I use this document for my later examples that you will see in digital notation. So the manuscript anticipates the ballet version, including markings for Massin, the choreographer, to portray orchestral forces. Also, in the final page, Ravel drew fascinating ink doodles, as Deborah Maurer calls them, resembling the form of dancers engaged in the fatal whirling of the waltz. This elaborate composition process shows just how pedantic Ravel was, A recollection by Manuel Rosenthal, who studied with Ravel after the war, gives evidence to his teacher's meticulous and uncompromising qualities. Once, when I came for my lesson, I saw the fire burning. Among the ashes, I could still see a piece of manuscript paper. I asked him what it is. "That's a good lesson for you," he said. "Sometimes you think I'm too harsh with you, too stern, too critical. Well, I have just destroyed the finale of the sonata for violin and piano. You know it, I've shown it to you," I said. "But the finale was really charming, a wonderful piece of music." He said, "I know, I liked it very much, but it didn't fit the sonata. It was not the right kind of finale for the first and second movements, so I have destroyed it and composed another finale, which is not so good, but it's a good finale." If it was only a preparatory version to the orchestral score, should La Valse be performed on the piano? Some criticize or diminish the expressive qualities of La Valse in its earlier version. Roger Nichols refers to the two-piano version as an inferior reproduction of the orchestral score, bringing out only the brutal and harsh sounds of La Valse. In his preparatory notes to the piano solo score reprint by Dover, Ronald Herder writes the following: "Ravel's transcription for solo piano incorporates occasional small note excerpts of orchestral elements from the full score. Since these are generally impractical or impossible to play along with the principal music, the player should regard those elements as references only to frame or give dimension to what is already there to perform." This bold statement does not consider the audience, who listens to a performance without a score, receiving only the auditory product. In this scenario, only the performer understands the meaning of La Valse, while the audience experiences a diluted version. Ravel wouldn't want that from a performance of La Valse on the piano. And there is strong evidence to suggest that Ravel did consider how La Valse sounds on the piano, and by extension that it might be performed, because he continued to edit the piano manuscript even after completing the orchestral score. Differences between the manuscript and published piano score include small details and correction in pencil, but more important, substantial differences of musical material are found in crucial passages, adding new material from the orchestra in osseous staves, material that expands the texture drastically and also highlights essential melodic ideas. In some spots, Ravel took material from the osseous staff in the manuscript and placed it as main material in the published score. Let's see a few examples to that. Here we see a section of La Valse. The upper line is the published score, and the bottom line is the manuscript. Note how bars 4 and 5 in the manuscript include the eighth note line in the osseous staff, which is transferred in the published score to the main material in the piano left hand. In the next example, we see the manuscript on the right and the published score on the left. What is only referential melody in the manuscript becomes a counter melody of equal importance in the published score for the left hand. In order to do that, Ravel had to compromise some of the sound. We don't get in the published score the same kind of full bass followed by chords in the waltz rhythm pattern, but instead we get in the published score a much higher sense of polyphony. These types of alterations show that Ravel wished for this material to be heard and not just referenced. The creative process shows Ravel's forward-thinking and flexible approach. Perhaps he envisioned that La Valse could be further developed by others, including more orchestral material with a virtuoso piano writing. He was certainly not against arrangements of his works. His good friend and pianist Lucien Garban transcribed many of Ravel's work during his lifetime, including Bolero for piano solo and La Valse for piano four hands. In order to do justice with Ravel's idea of apotheosis of the Viennese waltz, a performance of La Valse on the piano not only invites, but necessitates some sort of adaptation. I started learning La Valse more than 1 year ago, and it is a difficult process, mainly because of the need to adapt the score. It presents a great challenge, but also a wonderful opportunity to search all the time for new ideas to express by retranscribing Ravel. Ravel essentially took La Valse from the original piano versions to the orchestra, but it is the responsibility of the performing pianist to take the music back from the orchestra to the piano. In my own transcription, I started first by trying to mimic the orchestral sounds and trying to elevate aspects of dynamic and texture, rhythmic, polyphonic elements, all to be able to convey some of those dramatic gestures that are everywhere in the orchestral score. I owe my deepest gratitude to my teacher, Sergei Babayan, who gave me the initial inspiration and provided so many creative pianistic solutions to the transcription. This entire process was that of trial and error, lots of improvising on the piano, and trying to mimic those orchestral effects intuitively. After a while, I began to realize the deeper meanings that should be further explored in my transcription in regard to structure and motives in La Valse. A few analytic considerations are needed to highlight the essential material which I try to emphasize in my transcription. In addition to his socio-political associations in La Valse, David Epstein also stressed the piece's notion of étude as a study of the waltz idiom and of the Viennese style. Seen as such, Ravel's homage to the Viennese waltz could be interpreted as a reproduction, development, and ultimately a distortion of the Straussian formulas. George Benjamin's description of the formal sections of the piece as birth, life, decay, destruction fits this concept. Benjamin's concise analysis underscores the narrative of destruction and also sensitively shows that by manipulating recurring motifs, Ravel created captivating elements of foreshadowing and recollection. His use of motifs throughout the piece contributes immensely to the destructive themes. As melodies from the middle section are based on motivic ideas explored in the introduction, these are later cut into fragments in the recapitulation, alternating between one another in juxtaposition while being stripped from their previous stable tonal frames. Of the motivic ideas that are present in La Valse, none seem more relevant to the piece's narrative than the chromatic motif that you can see up on the screen, as well as elements of accentuation and metric ambiguity, which are all grounded in the introduction. In the top line, you see the seed for the chromatic motif, this alternating background sonorities of E and F. E is prolonged for the most part of the introduction, and later is ascends upward to include a six-note chromatic motif. The same motif recurs so many times throughout La Valse. In example B, it's the first example of the second line, you see an accompaniment figure of the chromatic motif given now in eighth notes, and the inverted versions creating a dynamic swell that creates a very tense texture. The next example could be found in the crescendo to the second climax. We see the inverted version of the motif, and it repeats relentlessly every bar, contributing to the sense of stress leading to the final catastrophe. In example D, which is taken from the coda, the motif is full-blown to the brass section, giving succession of chromatic triads in contrary motion. I think this is played by the trumpets and upper woodwinds. These are the metric components that are important in La Valse and treated almost as motives. You see the same opening material that I showed you before, but now notice that in the third beat we get a higher F, and it is orchestrated for harp and timpani. So that creates the contrast to the sound of the double basses, and by doing so accents the third beat, creating a sense of ambiguity of the bar. The same accent can be seen later in the first appearing of the brass in the piece. It's the second line, example C. It's given by muted horns. Also, this accentuation of beats, the second or third beats, keeps occurring throughout La Valse's disruptive motif. You can see in the third line, it's taking from one of the waltzes from the middle section, which Benjamin calls Life. And the second bar is a surprising accent of the trumpet, which is further emphasized by the bitonal implication of that measure of an E dominant seventh chord given above a C pedal in the strings and low wind instruments. Other metric components that contribute to the destabilized feeling in La Valse include the division of the uneven meter to even parts. You can see in the middle of the second line a melody of dotted quarter notes. In the piano score and the orchestral score, this is also given an accompaniment of quadruple eighth notes. So it goes against the expected grain of 3-4 time signature umpapa valse. And finally, we have lots occurrences of hemiolas throughout La Valse. Note the example B, it is top right. It's the first time that a hemiola is introduced in the introduction. It is given as a figure of tremolando to the strings. Later, when we finally achieve tonal stability and some sort of initial theme, that this is example E on the second line. So even then, Ravel destabilizes the waltz by including a melody that fits more to the 3-2 time signature on top of an accompaniment in the basses that keeps the 3-4 time signature. So we have polymeter. It so happens that in the piano version of La Valse, the essential motivic elements of chromaticism and meter were neglected to ossia references, or disappeared from the score altogether in favor of the principal themes of the waltzes. Clearly, the accompanying material should not come at the expense of the main melodies, but it must be regarded as indispensable in order to genuinely represent the chaotic reality of the piece. In my transcription, I sought to spotlight these motifs as much as possible while trying to maintain an efficient pianistic approach. Prior to the recapitulation at figure 54, we get a light scherzando section of brilliant orchestration with a playful melody in the flutes and clarinets and hemiolas. This is offset by sparkling accentuation of the second beat of each bar with the glockenspiel, oboe grace notes and pizzicato, and harmonics for violin. All that remains from this orchestral painting in the piano version is a pattern of trill and dotted half notes in alternating octaves taken from the viola and cello parts. You can see the example of how it appears in the piano score on the first line. While sensitive performance of the original piano version can portray the lighthearted character of this section, it cannot present the same level of registral variety and rhythmic pulse which exists in the orchestral counterpart Let's listen to this section in the orchestral version. I believe this is a recording by Charles Tetouan with the Montreal Orchestra. See that there's a lot more material going on than what Ravel wrote down in the piano version. For this reason, I tried to mimic the sounds of the orchestra in the piano by turning this whole section to be with a stronger rhythmic pulse. You can see an example of this transcription in the second and third line. What was the trill now became repeating minor seconds in staccato eighth notes, and that gives the yapapapapam a little bit more definition than the trill on the piano. Also, the oboe grace notes on the second beat are given each bar with alternating register. As a result of this alternating register, I had to redistribute the melodic material between the hands in something that is similar to what's called a third hand piano technique. I don't know if I should play some of this to you. I feel like I should save it for later. Another example of striking orchestral effect which loses its meaning in the piano version could be found at figure 95. Oh, that's not it. Sorry, let's go back. This is another example of missing accentuation in Ravel's original score. You can see on the top line both how it appears in the published score and in the manuscript, left hand in osseous staff. And on the bottom, you can see my transcription. It includes all of the material of the published score, but just redistributes it to be able to play those pizzicato references in the left hand. And basically, every time I play La Valse, I think of the orchestral score, and if something doesn't feel right, I try to change. This is one of my latest changes that probably happened in the past week. Here, this section is incredibly important to the structure of the piece. The same melody that he uses here, this is taken from the middle section, still very much alive, as Benjamin said. But the melody is later taken at the crescendo for the second climax. So, in essence, this part is foreshadowing of the growing tension that exists in La Valse. While there is no appearance of the chromatic motif here, or the a real metric ambiguity, like I mentioned before, we do see in the osseous staff a continuation of the surface rhythm in eighth notes. And while it is very helpful, you know, let's hear it in the orchestra first. Thank you. So as you can see, those eighth notes really give a sense of direction to the part, whereas in the piano, without those eighth notes, it results in something much more static. I'll try to play it as Ravel initially published, and without forcing it to sound too vertical, but you tell me how it sounds. So that way we receive something that is much closer to an homage to Johann Strauss than Ravel's take on the Viennese waltz. Here you can see a comparison of the transcribed version on the right and the published score on the left. So on the transcribed version, this underlying texture of eighth notes is provided as much as possible to the right hand, which continues to play the theme. And while it misses a few notes at the end of each bar, it fills the gap of the long note in the piano, and thus it allows it to live much longer acoustically. So the entire section becomes, instead of vertical, you get a lot more motion forward. This is the corresponding section before the second climax. Here you see the chromatic motif in the osseous staff above. At the manuscript score, this entire motif was absent. This is something that he only added to the published score. Let's hear it with the orchestra to really understand how much it is vital for this section. Dramatic. Other than possessing the importance of the motivic importance, this part, this orchestral material is crucial to the effect because of the gradual adding of instrument. The orchestral forces slowly by slowly become bigger and really gives the listener a sense of fear. It's frightening what's about to come. It starts at the double basses at first, then slowly moves up the score to the wind instruments in single voices, then in doubling voices, and then spread across the entire wind section until it is finally taken by the trumpets in a chromatic succession of triad chords. In the piano, however, it just sounds very empty. I'll demonstrate that again. I have heard, in fact, some exciting renditions of this section by pianists who didn't include the eighth notes material. But what it required them to do is play the section much, much faster, and thus it emphasized a lot more the act of accelerating instead of feeling this immense growing tension. So transcribing La Valse isn't only to include motifs, but in order to try and maintain this gestures that really define the musical meaning of the piece. In the transcribed version, you can see I've started with the eighth note material in the left hand. In fact, there isn't much material that goes to waste. It's basically a packed version of everything. Slowly by slowly, the eighth note's texture transfers upwards to the right hand. Until the right hand takes entirely this eighth note motive while still continuing to play the the melody. This part is extremely difficult to perform, but I find that the difficulty adds to the musical feeling. We need a little bit risk in order to portray this idea of destruction. If it's too easy, then, like I said before, the music turns into some showpiece to see how fast we can play the section and do an accelerando when accelerando is required. But rather than accelerando, I prefer to really try and evoke this very big climax that follows this section. This is already near the end of La Valse, before the coda. It's another, it's an example of accentuation issue. This is the published score. Let's listen to it with the orchestra. Okay, so a few different things between what we heard and what's on the page. This very special effect was something I tried to achieve forever in the transcription, but I don't know, something never worked in this place for me until this week, maybe a few days ago, that I kind of improvised, but I'll tell you about it soon. So we see here that instead of this jarring accent on the second beat, triumpa, ba-da-ti-yum-pa, Ravel wrote a crescendo to the third beat with this kind of sluggish triplet arpeggio in the right hand, and it simply doesn't work the same. It doesn't give the same sense of gut punching that the orchestra performs. There is also an acoustic problem. Note how the first beat, which is supposed to be the weakest, contains one of the strongest sonorities of an octave in the very low register of the piano. Especially if you consider that most of the basses come after a leap with the left hand. So in fast tempo, it would be difficult to create this subito piano effect going to fortissimo. And the third beat accent really doesn't work so much. Acoustically also, it is difficult to even think how in one beat could the piano create this crescendo. So after lots of improvisation of this section, I tried glissandi, I tried more pedal, less pedal, you name it, it didn't work. I'm very glad to present to you this solution. I decided to distribute the arpeggio in both hands, starting starting in the opposite direction that Ravel wrote. Instead of going from the bottom to the top, I start both hands in the middle register, spreading outwards. Going to the bass in the second beat really allows the piano to perform this fast crescendo, in my opinion, in a gesture much more resembling to the orchestral material than what Ravel originally wrote. This is also, you'll hear it in my performance at the end. So this is my final example for the evening. This is the catastrophic coda that George Benjamin called the destruction. This is looking at the orchestral score compared to what you see in the first line here, which I've taken from the manuscript just to show how different Ravel's idea of this section was from conception to completion. In the orchestral score, the first two bars of this section are given by the entire string section. Let me see. By the entire string section, with a glissando in the second bar of the tuba and trombone, and also low winds. So the orchestral forces are enormous. The third bar is supposed to be a triad chromatic succession in opposite directions of the trumpet and the upper winds. I think I showed you this example also before. But instead of this humongous orchestrated section, what Ravel wrote in the manuscript is nearly laughable, a single line texture, maybe two voices. So instead of a complete catastrophe, we get a Bach invention of the 20th century. So in the transcribed version, I tried to accomplish as much sound as I can from the piano by first lowering the chromatic motif in the left hand by an octave and doubling it with an octave in the right hand. You see in the second bar that I augment the initial chord to give a little more accent on the triple forte. And in the third bar, I also included the inverted chromatic motif in the left hand to be able to support the double thirds in the right hand. This has been a really eye-opening experience for me, and I think La Valse is the kind of piece that you live with for your entire life. I really hope that what you've just seen will inspire you to do the same in La Valse or any other piece that you choose to play and requires it. After all, nothing should be more important than conveying the meaning of the music on stage, and if it requires adaptation to be able to present to the composer's ideas in an effective manner, I think that there is every justification to do so. And I really expect to be playing this piece for many more years and changing a lot more spots for many more years. And I think I will play this for you now, and there will be time for questions after. Thank you. Thank you. I now invite you to ask questions about the piece, about the transcription, about maybe you have some ideas about what you've just heard, or about the process. I'm an open book. Yes, Susan.
This was really extraordinary. I mean, I felt more tense listening to this and watching this than I have even listening to or watching an orchestra. There's something about putting it back into a single person that really raises the level of tension, if you can pull it off, which you did. My question is, what do you expect to do with this? Do you, I believe you could publish your transcription if you wanted to, or you can continue to work on it, or you could do what Ravel does with his sketches and do the digital equivalent of throwing it in the fireplace. But, I mean, I think that the work you've done ought to be made available. What are your plans?
Two things. First, I know I've seen in this school's library another transcription of Laval's made by someone who included material from both the two piano versions and the orchestral score. Unfortunately, I don't remember his name, but something is already available for that. I think that perhaps I see a more positive thing in allowing it to become a part of a personal interpretation process. I don't think that if someone would hand out to me, okay, this is what you need to learn, play it. I don't think I would have learned on Laval's as much as I did by trying to figure out why do I need to change the score. I mean, other than just, you know, trying to make the piano sound like the orchestra. I mean, it goes a lot deeper than that. I think that the transcription process is something very essential to the part of learning this piece. On Sunday, April and I will play The Rite of Spring for four hands, and this is another piece which, by transcribing it, you learn so much about it. I don't think if Stravinsky would have had his own completed version, ready to play version of The Rite of Spring, I'm not sure that, again, like what I've just said about Laval's, that it would make the performers really think about what it is that they want to bring out in the material. Right now, I don't even have a notated version of the entire transcription. I wish I'd thought about scanning my score. It is full with, like, this is very little in cadules compared to my score. But maybe someday, I think I promised Sergei that I would give him a present with this, all of the places transcribed. So maybe. Anyone else? Okay, so I'd like to thank you very much for coming here today. Like Laval's, the past week for me has been on the verge of explosion, but it's over now. And I'm happy to be done and proud to be done, and thank you so much for sharing this moment with me, and have a good night.